I would put it up as the number one, the most important sacred site in the lands that we now call Canada. The relationship between water and land, plants, animals, and human beings, it's unique there. It's very powerful. It's one of those intangibles that are difficult to speak about. In fact, the more you try to speak about it, the more elusive it becomes. You actually have to experience it.
Tribes from all over North America used to journey up to Assanapka or Victoria Island. It was believed that there was a sacred pipe under the water, and they put offerings in the water, you know, bless the waters, thank the Creator.
It was always a place of many different nations, not just one. There was people gathering here and having ceremonies of agreement. You know, we were called Odawa, people of the trade, but our ancestors were always here, and we were always practicing our ceremonies here as well, too.
It is said that Samuel de Champlain, when he came here in 1613, writes in his journal that he saw First Nations people offering tobacco, making ceremony there.
That's the arrival of the Europeans. In their colonial mentality, now the Breton Flats is part of France.
It was like two different kind of economies, like a clash of lifestyles, where we have the Algonquins clearly living in harmony as well as living sustainably with the environment, but then we had the economy of the newcomers coming in, which had a direct negative impact upon the Algonquins, including in the area of the Breton Flats, where the logging and then the settlement coming after it really then impacts the Algonquin presence.
You had these 120-foot jack and white pines all the way up the valley, and that's perfect timber.
Le Breton Flats is really the beginning of Ottawa. The earliest settlers here in 1800 recognized the Chaudière Falls and Islands as potential hydro power for the lumber industry. Rail lines were brought in by Booth, and then everything started to move through by train into the United States. And Le Breton Flats became the residential area for the mills that were put up. Big fire, the Great Fire, yeah, well.
What ended up happening was the fire had leapt and had gone through the mills at that time, and then, of course, the clapboard houses and that, and the wooden shingles were setting everything on fire.
The Great Fire completely cleared the area, leveled it, that the flats became very flat.
After 1900, they reestablished the mills on the islands, and it became more heavy industry in Le Breton Flats.
It was a very busy community, vibrant.
C'était un mélange d'ouvriers, soit canadiens, français, des irlandais.
Ottawa having the nickname of the city that Fun forgot, well, not back when Le Breton Flats was bustling.
So we lived there. All my brothers were born there. I was born there. We all were born in the Grace Hospital. It was a great place to live, but let's face it, it was an industrial area, town. Smokestacks and trains, and they were using coal. I mean, it was grungy.
I was only like probably second-story houses all in Le Breton Flats. It wasn't anything big that I can remember.
My mom would take me across there, across Booth at Albert, and it was like right out of the 50s. The supermarket was called Fishbane's. Mr. Fishbane would stand there, and his wife had the, you know, 1950s dress with the pearls, and they had everything there. And as a kid, it was magical. My mom worked at Sandy's, but when we hit hard times, she stole a can of salmon because we had nothing to eat. And to her dying day, she always felt bad. I can remember certain nights she would have a piece of white bread and some molasses, and that was her supper. And that's all you had. But I love the fact that everybody knew everybody.
People looked after other people. I remember I was in the sleigh with my grandfather, and he had a buffalo robe, and he was driving it. Light snowfall coming, just a few snowflakes coming down. But the jingle bells and the horses were all dressed up in their best with the bells on and the bows on, and we were singing carols in both French and English. People were coming out of their houses, and there was this little girl, and I remember she was hiding behind her mother's big coat, and she was terrified, and she was looking at me. And I was wondering, what was she looking at? And of course, my grandfather had gone out and bought me this big lollipop. And I was sitting there, and I suddenly realized she was looking at my lollipop. And I turned around, and I realized, oh, she'd love this lollipop. And I turned around, and I got out of the sleigh and gave her the lollipop. And then, of course, she ran behind her mother and was just so thrilled at having it.
Mr. Gruber was brought over from France by our prime minister to turn Ottawa into a classy capital, and he decided that all this riffraff had to go. Part of his plan was to demolish this neighborhood.
Had you and I been living on the Breton Flats in April 1962, we would have got a notice through the door from the NCC saying you have 2 years to vacate.
Alors, ils étaient désemparés lorsqu'ils ont perdu leur logis. Je crois que c'est un aspect qui est souvent oublié des plaines de Breton.
The NCC had acquired the lands in the 60s for what was at the time to have been a Department of National Defense headquarters. There was a massive plan for the creation of what they called Pentagon North. And the NCC was used as the agent of the Crown to acquire the lands.
People were lamenting the loss of community and the loss of housing. It was a lot of individual sad stories about people's homes being removed.
I moved to Ottawa in 1974, and at that time, the flats were not redeveloped. We used to fly kites on the flats because it was big enough open space to do that.
The NCC ran a campground for 20, 25 years probably. It wasn't fancy, but it was well used.
J'ai un souvenir de dans la voiture de mes parents d'avoir demandé à ma mère pourquoi il y avait des tentes au centre-ville d'Ottawa.
When I saw a camping ground within sight of Parliament, I thought, well, that's democracy in action. You can hitchhike your way across the country and come and stay here for $10 a night.
It was an interesting place. It was a really interesting place. Pope said mass here. You know, that was actually a pretty good use of that space because they used it at the natural amphitheater.
I had the day off school.
Back then it was just, there was one big sort of lawn. Let's say called an area with grass.
The early days of the Blues Fest
was our little version of Woodstock in the heart of the capital, you know.
Je sais, un soir, j'ai un très beau souvenir d'être avec des amis, d'écouter Blue Rodeo. Et ensuite, le retour à la maison, c'était vraiment quelques pas avant de me rendre chez moi dans mon condo.
We presented all the acts you can think of.
Wilson Pickett.
The Dixie Chicks.
James Brown.
Kiss, Iron Maiden.
I can remember one year they had a small tent that was set up. My sister and I went. I can remember sitting listening to Kate and Anna McGarrigle and looking down and there was a running shoe sticking up out of the dirt. And that was because of the snow dump. You had all kinds of contamination that was there because of the former uses. But there was an asphalt plant, ironworks, dry cleaners, paintworks, foundries, you name it, it was out there. So we had groundwater that had to be pumped out and treated. There were millions of cubic meters of fill that were taken.
Without the remediation, there wouldn't have been any archaeological work done.
Got a great site. You know, the plan calls for
taking down the Ottawa River Parkway from its elevated status right by the river. We're going to pull it back further south. There's going to be a great riverfront site right there that you could use. So, bada boom, bada bing, decision to do the War Museum on the flats, and with it came millions of dollars of federal funding. So the NCC was able to take the parkway down, move it, do all kinds of site remediation, new piped infrastructure, new roads. So the War Museum happened. And that started the project. If it wasn't for the War Museum, it's possible the flats could be sitting looking like it did, you know, 20 years ago.
The thing that's neat about this is there's very few other large urban centers where you can paddle whitewater in the middle of the city.
I, a lot of the times, go sit down by the water and go and see people on their whitewater rafting kayaks, even the short little ones.
I'm seeing life return to LeBreton Flats. I'm seeing the Mill Street Brew Pub pop up and service the skiers of the S-Jam with nice, delicious food and craft beer and the Canadian War Museum. So I'm seeing a resurgence. I think only good things could come, provided that we keep its natural inherent beauty. And I actually think it's a blessing in disguise. It's forcing us to really think this through.
You really have to understand where you're coming from before you know where you're going.
I'm going to remain optimistic. I believe that the next generation is asking good questions. I believe that we've got a lot of turbulence ahead. But if we're going to survive as human beings on this land, then it has to be a step in the journey of a more positive and a more thorough respect for the sacred site.
We still have rights. We are still here, in spite of everything that happened. The Algonquins living in Ottawa, the school there, working there. There's an opportunity to do something unique as a site within the National Capital Area, within the city of Ottawa, to demonstrate, that Aboriginal people can be involved and can be a part of a development, but not just for names or street signs or the mural or something concrete, to be there for the long term, to benefit for it and provide a positive input.